ಪಾರ್ಟಿಸಿಪೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಒಂದು 20 ಜನ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, 20 ಜನ ಮೇಲೆ ಇರಂಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ.
60 ಪ್ಲಸ್ ಜಾಯಿನ್ ಆಗ್ತಾರೆ ಸರ್.
ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ, ಸುಮಾರು ಜನ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ.
ಪ್ಲಸ್ ಫ್ಯಾಕಲ್ಟಿ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ವಾ? ಅದಕ್ಕೆ
Good afternoon to all the participants and the esteemed speaker. Afternoon session of day 4 of STTP. So with the kind consent of the principal and convener, we are starting today's session of AICT sponsored 1-week STTP program. So I take this privilege to introduce our today's guest for this session, Shri N.G. Lakshmi Narayan. He is the Chief Business Development Officer, New Delhi, and also IC Coordinator, IPFC at Bangalore. Sir holds a MSc as well as M.Tech in Biotechnology and Engineering from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. His skill summaries include that he has 25 plus years of experience in management of innovation, technologies, acquisition, evaluation, protection, value addition, and commercialization in the areas of agriculture, horticulture, sericulture, agriculture, chemicals, applied microbiology, food and nutrition sciences, biochemistry, plant and animal biotechnology, etc. He also has a skill set in intellectual property evaluation and management. He's an advisory and consultancy service to R&D organization, individuals, micro, small and medium enterprises. He's been into training, mentoring and managing team members in the process of technology commercialization and associated services. He's also into organizing and managing scientific events, delivering technical lectures, rapporteuring in seminars, workshops, and conferences. Sir's major achievements include that he has initiated commercialization of innovations and technologies which are developed by laboratories which are associated with Central Silk Board and other R&D organizations. It also includes institutes immediately after joining as deputy manager at NRDC New Delhi. He's also collaborated with several R&D institutions by way of signing MOUs and MOAs for providing intellectual property protections, technology commercialization, and other value-added services. He's also identified, assessed, and got assigned 260 technologies and technical know-how to NRDC from various R&D laboratories and individual inventors for protecting and commercializing them. He's concluded 250 technology transfer license agreement in various sectors during the past 22 years. He has established a wide clientele with network of R&D organization and industries in South India. He has generated revenue of more than 4.44 crores from lump sum premier for technology licensed at NRDC. He has organized NRDC annual conferences, Innovate India 2009, 2013, and also 2015. He has implemented the project on intellectual property facilitation centers, which is jointly funded by Ministry of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises. Identified NGOs which are located in rural areas and coordinated the setting up of rural technology demonstration cum training centers, RTDTC, in South India. He has also established an insect pathology laboratory and initiated research work on biological control of insect pests during tenure as research associate at University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore. Sir, we are overwhelmed to have you here. On behalf of the management, the principal, the HOD, staff and students of the Oxford College of Engineering and Department of Biotechnology, we welcome you for being our guest speaker for today's session, sir. So it's welcome and it's over to you to start with the session.
Thank you, Dr. Salma, and I wish to first of all thank Dr. Manjunath and Oxford College of Engineering for having given me this opportunity for sharing few of my experiences in NRDC and telling about our services and the achievements that we have been doing. Okay, see, basically we are a technology transfer company under the Ministry of Science and Technology. We are a small enterprise. We are a public sector organization under the Department of Scientific and Industrial Research, which is one of the departments under the Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India. Okay, see, we were incorporated way back in 1953 as a small Section 25 company. Now, under the Companies Act 2013, we are now a Section 8 company with a mandate of promoting, developing, and commercializing technologies which are developed indigenously. And most of our sources of technologies are the national R&D institutions like ICR, ICMR, DRDO, and universities, central universities, state agriculture universities, ICR. And of course, we also work with many individual inventors who assign technologies to NRDC for commercialization. Okay, we are a technology transfer company. And we also provide associated services like filing intellectual property protection for all the technologies that we acquire from various R&D institutions. And we also undertake project consultancies for various public sector undertakings, as well as the projects under other ministries also, which I'll be discussing in detail in the subsequent slides. Our strength is we have a strong linkage with R&D institutions, both public and private, and we have a large clientele of industries who are our licensees and our associated partners. Sometimes they are our clients also, to whom we have provided services. We are headquartered in New Delhi, and we have an outreach office in Visakhapatnam to service the clients in South India. So the basic mandate of NRDC is to provide technology transfer services. This is one of our commercial activities that we undertake. That is even filing of protection and protection of scientific and technological advancements of the laboratories, of individual innovators, of the corporates. All these are being facilitated through NRDC. And out of these technologies that we have been filing patents and filing protection, we identify a few technologies which could have very high commercial potential. And we pick them up and we do some kind of a value addition, and then we process them for commercializing them through the Indian industries. And we also, as I was telling you, we implement a lot of consultancy projects of other PSUs and ministries. These are our commercial activities, which are our bread and butter for our survival. And we also implement promotional programs of the Government of India under two different schemes. The first scheme is called Program for Development of Technologies for Commercialization, under which we have various sub-schemes in which we provide assistance, we provide value addition, and we provide a lot of other services for the development and transfer of technologies. And there is another program called Program for Inspiring Inventors and Innovators. In this scheme, we provide assistance for filing patents, trademarks, designs, all such activities. And we also used to provide some kind of an assistance to organizations who would like to conduct the IPR seminars or workshop in their organization for the benefit of the faculty as well as the research and development students. Okay, these are our broad mandate of NRDC in which we operate. This is in nutshell about how the operation model of NRDC is for taking forward technologies for commercialization. On the left, you see the sources of our technologies. It could be laboratories, national laboratories, it could be universities, it could be corporate R&D, it could be individuals, even some NGOs under which we have a lot of R&D developments happening. These are all some kind of our sources of technologies. And once we acquire the technology rights, so what we do is we need to do a lot of value addition to these technologies. So the value addition in terms of evaluation of the technology for its commercial feasibility and its technological feasibility, this is done by NRDC. And we also provide some kind of an assistance Tripathi. Assistance for technology development in terms of funding to take forward these technologies. In the subsequent slides, I'll be in mentioning about what is the kind of funds that we provide for technological developments. And on in parallel, we also suggest the R&D institutions and the innovators on the IPs that needs to be filed for these technologies. IPs could be basically patents, which cover the function or working of the technology. And parallelly, we also suggest we could also take a design registration if it is some kind of a device which has a unique appearance, or it could be even a trademark if you have given a very unique name for the product, so you can go for filing a trademark. So a bundle of rights form the rights of the technology, which is going to be transferred to the industry. So we need to protect the technology in all ways possible. In fact, even there is a possibility of even taking a copyright on the kind of label that you prepare for pasting it on the product. That also could be a copyright registration that you could take. So there are so many rights that you could take for an individual technology that you develop in your laboratories. So in addition to that, we also do some value addition in terms of market survey, wherein in market survey, we try to find out what is the potential of this particular product or a technology or a service if it is launched in the market. So we basically approach the industry associations that are associated with that particular sector for which the technology has been developed. And we try to get information on how this technology could behave or how this product could behave if it is launched in the market. So this is all outsourced to market consultancy companies. We define the scope of work, we outsource it, and they get the work done by surveying across the nations, looking for secondary information sources, and talking to all the industry associations, or sometimes even the industries themselves who are in that particular sector, they are also approached and their feedback also taken on the technology. So all this is culled out and made into a report and submitted to NRDC. This gives us confidence in moving forward. So these are some of the value additions that we do. Business development, we promote the technology in various ways, like participating in exhibitions, putting up the information on our website, on social media platforms. So in fact, NRDC is in almost all social media platforms now. We advertise about our technology. We release on a day-to-day basis, we release a lot of technologies which are developed for commercialization. These are some of the business development that we do for promoting the technologies in the market. And we also do some kind of a market intelligence reports for finding out what its feasibility when it is suppose the industry requires a intelligence report on its feasibility. So a feasibility report is also prepared by NRDC, and the feasibility report forms a basis for their detailed market detailed project report, which they submit to the bankers for getting funds or for getting loans and other activities. So there are a lot of other such value additions that we do. The BEDP, that is called Basic Engineering Design Package. This is a value addition that we do for technologies which are process related. For example, if it is a biotech or a pharma related process, so there is a basic engineering design. There are software platforms like ChemCAD, Visimix, and so many other software platforms on which the basic parameters on the technology, which are developed at a laboratory scale, that is fed into the software platform, and the whole process is simulated in the software. And once there is a simulation is done and it gets stabilized on a scale that you require for an operations. For example, if an innovator has developed a process for maybe 50 grams or maybe 50 grams or 100 grams or 1 kg per day, so if you would like to scale it up to maybe 500 kgs or 1000 kgs per day, so you require a certain kind of an investment if you really would like to do it in a physical form. That is, if you would like to put up a pilot plant, then you would like to study that. So you require a lot of investment, you require a lot of time on developing a pilot plant. So in this case, we have dedicated software platforms which are highly sophisticated, which are highly so advanced that you can simulate the whole process on a software platform. And based on the simulation and studies which are done on the simulation software, the process can be stabilized. And once it is stabilized, you can scale it up to a level of operations which the industry would like to operate, maybe 1000 kg per day. So once it is stabilized at 1000 kg per day, you can just at a click of a button get the specification of the plant and machinery, the entire inventory of whatever raw materials are required, what ingredients are required, what purity, what is the quantity required. Everything can be derived just by one click of a button. So advanced are the softwares now available for process softwares, process related products which are developed. So we also carry out such works using third party resources and market consulting companies. So these are made by NRDC, which will help the industry as well as the innovator in knowing where we stand and what is the level that this particular technology could be taken once it is released to the market by to get absorbed by the industry. And as I was telling you, feasibility reports, publicity, we give a lot of publicity to technologies and innovations which are being assigned to NRDC. We participate in a lot of seminars organized by NRDC or by third party agencies. We put up stalls in exhibitions. So all these are some of value additions that we do for technologies. And once these value additions are done, parallelly we also do the marketing. So industries or entrepreneurs who are interested in these technologies, who feel they can confidently pick up these technologies and take it forward to the industrial level, they are given the license, and then the technology gets licensed, and the next step happens and handholding happens by NRDC. The laboratory provides the training, demonstration, and the know-how document to the industries, and they take it forward. So this is in broad nutshell about how the technologies are processed at NRDC and they are commercialized by NRDC. These are some of the institutions with whom we have been associated. It is a big list, but here there is only a small list of technology partners that we have put here. It could be CSIR, ICR, COIR Board, ICMR, DRDO, CDOT, many of the agriculture universities, even corporates like Neyveli Lignite Corporation, many of the ICR institutions, universities, plenty of them are associated with NRDC for commercializing their technologies. These are some of our customers to whom we have licensed technologies or we have provided services consultancy services or for filing their IPs. BML has been one of the major companies, and there are other defense public sectors which have been using our services for filing patents of whatever developments that are happening in their R&D units. So let me briefly explain you how technologies are taken forward from NRDC to the industry. So as I was discussing with your principal, Dr. Kannan, we formally offer offer the institution with whom we are associated to enter into an MOA. MOA is nothing but Memorandum of Agreement for providing services related to transfer of technology as well as the filing of intellectual property rights which the R&D institution develops. Then once the MOA is ratified by both the organizations, we sign the MOA and we outline what is the role of each organization in the MOA and the way the revenues are shared. Usually revenues are shared in the ratio 70-30 with most of the government R&D institutions. The revenue sharing formula is 70-30. 70% of the revenues that we generate out of licensing or from royalties received, we remit back to the R&D institution. 30% of the revenues are retained by NRDC for their services. And once this MOA is signed and we start getting the information about the technologies, we have a technology acquisition format in which it is quite elaborate. The technology acquisition format is so elaborate that most of the innovators are not able to completely fill the form. So it is so elaborate. But we request the innovator to the extent possible, he or she could fill up the format and take support from NRDC officials in understanding what are the requirements for marketing the technology. See, technology can be marketed by NRDC professionals or officials only after we get to know about the information on the technologies that you people have developed. So the more information you provide, it becomes more easy for us to convince an industry to sell the product or sell the services, sell the technology. So that's why we request the innovators to provide as much details as possible about the technology. If they don't understand the format, they can always come back to us and get to know what is the way it is to be filled, what are the requirements. Of course, see, this is a learning exercise because this once you fill up this technology acquisition format, it becomes easy for you to also prepare the technical know-how document. So which is going to be provided to the industry who acquires the license. So this is going to be a very important document for you people in the beginning itself, so that, see, we stress on this documentation because as such we have experienced the scientific fraternity, or in general we are very poor in documenting our activities or our work or our research. So this actually will help you in knowing what the industry requires. So for example, if you specify that you are supposed to use a refrigerator, okay, refrigerator, what kind of refrigerator you need to specify. What is the size, what is the capacity, what is its rating, what is its power consumption, what is its make. Everything is supposed to be specified in that particular document. So once you start working on these technologies, so you will realize, see, for every instrument or every device or every process that you use or process that you develop, there are series of instruments or equipments that you are going to use. So you need to know and understand what is the rating of these instruments or the capacity of these instruments. So once this is documented, it becomes very easy for you to further extrapolate or scaling up the technology. So it actually facilitates the technology transfer to the industry in a very smooth way. Suppose you specify the capacity of maybe a centrifuge. Okay, centrifuge could be, it could be a refrigerated centrifuge or a tabletop centrifuge. It could be so many types of centrifuges are available now. So you need to specify what kind of centrifuge, what speed, what RPM, what could be the rotor size, all these activities, all these features, all these things are very much required, because for an industry to use that particular technology, he needs to build a scaled up technology. He needs to put up a centrifuge of a industrial scale. So if the basic information is not provided, how will he go forward in making a bigger technology or implementing the technology in a bigger way or scaling up the technology? So all these activities are very much in required. So I request the scientific faculty to understand what this technology acquisition form is. We will be circulating that with the your organizers, so that you will be able to understand and take forward these aspects and disseminate the information to your colleagues and others, yeah, juniors who are developing technologies. So once we receive the information as per this format, we do the preliminary assessment. Assessment is done for its commercial viability, economic feasibility. It's so many other activities that we do is we try to find out whether it is really competitive in its nature. Suppose there is an existing technology which is much more better than the technology that you have developed. So it becomes very difficult for us to promote the technology. So we need to compare the product or the services that you are developing with service what is already existing in the market. So if it is better, only then the industry will show interest. So we need to make this assessment before we release the technology to the public. So preliminary assessment of the technologies are done. If it is found suitable, if it is found very commercially potential, economically feasible, then we also suggest what are the future measures to be taken, for example, taking IP protection for the technologies. All this is done in parallel. And if it is found commercially potential, then we request the R&D institute to assign the technology. That is, the technical know-how associated with your technology needs to be assigned to NRDC for marketing the technology or for doing the commercialization activity. Suppose you have filed a patent, so we will not request for the assignment of the patent. We will request the assignment of the technical know-how associated with these patents or associated with any of the IPs that you have filed. So that is assigned to NRDC for commercialization. We put a rider of minimum duration of 5 years because the technology transfer doesn't happen overnight. So it takes a lot of time for the technology to mature even after the development from the laboratory. To take it forward to the field condition, to convince an industry, it requires a lot of time. So that's why a minimum duration of 5 years is requested for assigning the technology. Then, as I was telling you, the value additions that we do, market survey, market analysis, techno-commercial feasibility, viability, basic engineering design, package, feasibility studies, all these activities are done for the value addition of the technologies. And with this information, we get a lot of confidence in moving forward because these are study reports or the activities which give us a lot of information on how the technology could behave in the market. So these studies are very much essential, and these studies reports are also shared with the innovators so that they also get to know how the technology will behave or how these value additions can be done. And these are also going to help you in preparing the technical know-how document. These reports, the basic information in these reports are also helpful in making the technical know-how document. So with that information, we also, NRDC prepares technology profiles on each technology. We don't give critical information on these technologies. And with the help of the innovator, we prepare these technology profiles. It could be sometimes 1 page, 2 pages, or 3 pages. And we start circulating this particular technology profile among the prospective industries who could be our customers or clients who could take the technology. Okay. And once the prospective industry shows interest, we invite them. We also involve the researchers in discussion on how this product could be commercialized. What could be the price of the product? Samples of the product also are provided with or without MTA. The MTA is nothing but a material transfer agreement. MTEA is nothing but a material transfer evaluation agreement. These are some of the preliminary requirements when we provide samples of the product for testing by the prospective industries. And parallelly, we also decide on what are the technology transfer terms and conditions in association with the industry, as well as sometimes R&D organizations. And once both the organizations are agreeable on the terms and conditions, we get it formally approved by the respective organizations, and then we offer it to the industry for licensing. So normally the technology terms and conditions are as follows: lump sum premium. Lump sum premium is the technology fee, that is upfront fee that is paid by the industry before we release the technical know-how. So usually it is a substantial amount when the technology is acquired. And in addition to that, we have a recurring royalty on ex-factory sales price. A recurring royalty varies with the type of the product. If it is a bulk product like a food product, which is consumed in, which is produced in a large quantity, usually the recurring royalties are varying between 1% and 2% on ex-factory sales. And if it is a chemical, so the recurring royalty is usually 3% or 3.5%, something like that. And if it is an equipment or a device or something like that, or where the numbers are, numbers that get sold is less, so the royalty will be slightly higher. It could be 5 or 7.5%. So depending on the nature of the product, we fix the recurring royalties. And period of license, invariably it is 10 years. Very rarely the period of license changes. On a case-to-case basis, depending on the nature of the technology, the validity of the license could also be enhanced. We have recently enhanced the validity of a license to 20 years for a particular technology. So that is also a possibility. So we have a very flexible model of operations. So there is no need to worry that it has to be 10 years or something like that. It could be enhanced. There is no problem at all. So nature of license, usually technologies that we acquire from the government R&D institutions are given on a non-exclusive basis. And sometimes on a limited exclusivity is given only when the industries that come forward for acquiring the license, they also invest in the further development of the technology. In that case, there is a limited exclusivity or small monopoly rights given for a period of maybe 2 years or 3 years from the date of commercialization, or 5 years from the date of signing of the license agreement, something like that. We give a limited exclusivity so that the industry which invests on the development of technology recovers its cost. And then further, after the exclusivity period is over, we offer this technology to the other industries. Sometimes demonstration charges are taken from the licensees, and service taxes, of course, GST, whatever is prevailing at the time of the transfer of the technology or signing of the license agreement, we collect GST. Now it is around 12% on the lump sum premium and on the recurring royalties. So once the technology terms and conditions are finalized, we formally offer the technology to the industry. There is a standard offer letter that we have prepared, and based on that, we offer these terms and conditions. The licensee is also provided a license application form, which he needs to fill up and submit to us, along with the payments. Once the payments are done and the licensee submits the license application form, we prepare a license agreement, which is quite elaborate, which outlines the role of NRDC, outlines the role of the R&D institution, outlines the role of the industry once the technology is transferred. So all these clauses are built into this license agreement form, and it is executed by both licensee and NRDC. And subsequently, NRDC, once the agreements are signed on both the parts, that is NRDC and the licensee, so we request the R&D institution to go ahead and release the technology. So the technology is released in terms of giving a hands-on training, demonstration of the process, and providing the technical know-how document. Technical know-how document, if the innovator requires, on how the technical know-how is to be prepared. So we can share a few content sheets of technical know-how documents that are available with NRDC. So that you get to know what is the actual content on how the know-how document has to be prepared, what are the various parameters, contents, and all those things can be seen from this content sheet. and you can get to know how on how this can be prepared. So basically, the technical know-how demonstrated will have all these kind of data on plant layout, specification of the plant machinery, as I was telling you, when you prepare the technology acquisition format. So most of these are going to be a repetition. So you need to just cut and paste the, that information into the technical know-how document. So provide data dossiers pertaining to test trials as well as MSDS for products and byproducts, details on manpower requirement, utilities, techno-economics of the production at the scale developed. You can provide a rate of returns. All these data is provided to the licensee. And details on the pollution control, hazard management, and other mandatory clearances that are required for starting the factory or releasing the product, before releasing the product, what are the mandatory clearances that needs to be taken are also provided in the know-how document. And once this is transferred, the training and demonstration depends on the nature of the product or the level at which the technology has been developed by the R&D laboratory. So see, when we offer the technology, invariably we offer the technology on an as-is-on wear basis. So the industry which acquires the license so is very clear about what is the level of the technology that we provide to them. So even the R&D institution is also going to provide the training and know-how demonstration at the scale that they have developed, not necessarily at the scale of operations by the industry. So we provide this, and once this is the training is done, the R&D institution as well as the licensee sign a certificate to the effect that the licensee who acquires the technology is satisfied with the process, and he is happy with the training and demonstration that is being provided. So that actually completes the transfer of the technology. So from now onwards, after the training and demonstration is done, the licensee needs to go back and set up his factory and start producing the product. And wherever there are troubleshooting require, the concerned technical officer or the concerned innovator who has developed the product could be deputed to the premises of the factory. And they could be helping them in getting the product out from the factory. So all these hand-holding services also are to be provided until the product is released into the market. So since this is going to be our baby, so the innovators as well as NRDC officials have the responsibility of ensuring that the licensee starts the manufacturing of the product to his desired level. Okay, once he manufactures the product and sells in the market, he starts paying royalty to NRDC on a biannual basis as per the license agreement clause that we have executed with him. And as I was telling you, when we signed the MOU, we decided on the sharing ratio of the revenues. So I was telling you, with government R&D, it is 70-30. With private institutions and private R&D, as well as individual innovators, the sharing ratio is 50-50. So based on the MOA conditions, terms and conditions, we released the share of the R&D share on an annual basis once the NRDC accounts are rendered in a year. Okay, so once this is done, so every year we are supposed to release the R&D share to the R&D institutions along with the technology that has been transferred. The amount of money that we have received, there is a big statement that we prepare and we remit the R&D share along with that particular statement, which gives you the details on which technology has been commercialized and which are the industries to whom we have licensed, at what price the technology has been transferred, what is the royalties that we have received. All that is put into a statement and then given to the R&D institution along with our R&D share. So if the technology has been patented or any other form of IP protection has been taken, we will jointly review what is to be done and who pays the annuity all that we need to decide on whether we need to continue maintaining the patents once it is commercialized. And post licensing studies, of course, now we have started a small activity called socioeconomic impact assessment study for few technologies which have seen good commercial success. So the ministry has requested us to do this assessment study for at least a few technologies to know how the technology has impacted the society after it is commercialized by NRDC. And the ministry has been giving us some small grants for carrying out this particular study. And we have been outsourcing this activity to the market consulting companies, which are doing the work for us. So this is the in broad how the technology commercialization happens from lab scale technologies to the industries. So it is a sort of a repetition, so I'm not going to discuss much on that. So we have few case studies. You must be aware that we have a central cell board very close to your Oxford institution, which we have entered into MOU with them way back in 1995. And this association continues for such a long time. And they have a network of laboratories that are spread across the country. And India has been very fortunate that we have been working on all the four species of silkworms, which is very unique to our country. That is the mulberry silk, the tassar silk, eri and muga. All these four species of silkworms, we have been working on that. And Silk Board is responsible for carrying out all the R&D activities and the commercial aspects of all these various silk forms. And once, after we signed the MOA in 1995, the Silk Board Associated Laboratories have been giving us a lot of applications for filing IPs. We have filed more than 158 IPs. It could be mostly they are patents. There are a few trademarks. Design registrations. Otherwise, most of the IPs that we have filed are patents. Out of these 158 IPs, we have commercialized 52 technologies and concluded more than 126 license agreements across the country and earned a revenue of about 2.6 crores only from technology fee. I don't have the data on the royalties that are received by NRDC. This is a continuous process. Royalties are received for over a period of 10 years for each technology. And in fact, even after the technologies are expired, that is after 10 years, the companies have been coming back to us and paying the fee and getting the technology license agreements renewed for another 10 years. So this is the potential of the technologies that the Silk Board has. So this has been a very, very successful experience with Central Silk Board. Though we don't know how people perceive that, even for silkworms, there is so much of R&D work happening. So this is another laboratory, which is in Bangalore, Indian Institute of Horticulture Research. This is an ICR laboratory. We signed an MOA in 2009 and concluded in 2016. We have 5 IPRs filed and 8 technologies were assigned. All the 8 technologies which were assigned have been commercialized. And we issued 42 licenses across India, and we earned about 54 lakhs in terms of technology fees. There is one doubt that definitely people will have 5 IPRs and 8 technologies. So what about the 3 other technologies for which there is no IPR? So most of the technologies, people misunderstand that technologies should invariably have IPs to commercialize. No, not necessary. It could be in the form of a trade secret. The technologies could be in the form of a trade secret. Why not? Why should we not commercialize a technology which is a trade secret? So we have several trade secret technologies in the market. So we have been licensing technologies which are like a trade secret. For example, even in CFTRI, we have seen that the institute has been licensing technology on mango pickle. So what is great about mango pickle? But in spite of that, CFTR has been licensing the mango pickle technology. So this is nothing but some kind of a recipe which has a lot of secrets in how the ingredients are mixed, how the ingredients are prepared, how it is sourced. All that forms the technical know-how. So that technical know-how is transferred to the industry. There is another case study, Indian Institute of Spices Research. So there is a dedicated R&D institution on spices, which is located in Calicut. So we signed the MOU in 2012 and it is ongoing. We had a request for filing 4 IPRs and we have filed all the 4 IPRs. Their patents have been also granted. And they have assigned us about 16 technologies. Out of them, 6 have been commercialized. And we have issued 17 licenses across India. And there are several already in pipeline which we have been marketing. And we have generated a revenue of 32.5 lakhs from technology fees that we have licensed from Indian Institute of Spices Research. So this is an institution where there is only work on the spices crops. So you can imagine the potential the spices have in our country. So we have an outreach center in Visakhapatnam where we provide the facilities for doing patent search and other allied activities, including technology transfer. So we have about 5 people working in Vizag office and all these activities are being done. They have been equipped well and they provide exactly the similar services what NIRDC Delhi provides in Vizag. They are catering to the clients in South India. So this is one of the corporate social responsibility technologies that we have been operating as of now. But since from this year onwards, this particular scheme has been withdrawn by the ministry. We used to earlier provide grants to NGOs to organize entrepreneurship development program in rural areas, wherein a funding of up to 4 lakhs was provided to the development agencies to promote entrepreneurship in their region using the locally available resources and the locally available human capital. So these were the basic criteria wherein they have to use the locally available resource and the human capital for training them and bringing out products which are very novel. And of course, this particular scheme was highly competitive. We used to receive around 400-500 proposals every year, out of which we used to support about 20 NGOs. And it was a huge hit in the among the NGOs. This is one of the activities that we used to do, but as of now, we have discontinued this activity. And of course, I was telling you, we have a small component of export of services. Wherever there has been a commercial success in our country of technologies that we have licensed, we try to export these technologies to the countries where it has relevance. Like, for example, there is a briquette making machine which is very popular in Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat, all these places. There are a lot of agro waste available. And these agro waste are converted into briquettes. And these briquettes are used for boiling, the firing in the boilers or in various places where there is a requirement of the firewood. So these briquettes are very popular in these areas where there are a lot of agro waste available. So this particular technology had demand in some African countries. So we could export this particular technology to even African countries where the licensee who used to manufacture the machine gets an opportunity to go and implement the technology in those countries. So the Ministry of External Affairs had given us grants. We had we set up a training center in Ivory Coast, and we are trying to even replicate the same in other countries, in Uganda, Ghana, and all other countries where it is of much relevance of the technologies are of much relevance compared in vis-a-vis the country's requirement. So in fact, last year we concluded a project on tomato cultivation in Ghana. So these are some of the technology sectors that we handle in NIRDC. Name the industry sector, we are in all the sectors except probably software. We handle almost all industry technology sectors in NIRDC. some of the popular technologies that we have commercialized by NRDC. You must be familiar with the infant food. When we used to be kids, I remember Amul used to produce these infant food and supply to the market. Swaraj tractors, Indelible Ink for election purpose. In fact, Indelible Ink is a unique technology where we have given a monopoly rights to one of the companies in Mysore Paints, which is manufacturing this particular Indelible Ink for almost around 40 to 50 years now. And we have been renewing the license on an exclusive basis. So there is a sensitivity involved, hence the technology is being licensed and renewed every year only to one company. Cinemark, you must be familiar when we used when the earlier projectors, they used to use the cinema arcs for illumination. So these are technologies of the 70s and 80s, where cinema projectors used to use these arc carbon softwareites. All these were the very highly consumable products, which were very successful in those days and those era. Of course, now with the advent of the multimedia projectors, these projectors have vanished from the scene now. So there are the huge list of technologies which have been very successful. I will go to a few of them on a case-to-case basis. We have this. Since this is a platform where we need to talk about technologies in the bio stream and the agriculture stream, this is a particular technology which we have sourced from University of Agriculture Sciences, Bangalore, and we have also commercialized this technology to 2-3 companies in Bangalore itself. This is I think most of you are familiar. Making a ragi mudda is not easy. It requires a lot of skill. Otherwise, you will land up making lumps in the mudde. So this is an instant ready-to-use mudde mix, wherein you need to just mix it with water, with a definite proportion of water, and just steam it. So of course, the mudde takes the shape of the container, but you can just scoop it out and make nice ragi balls out of it and provide it to the consumers. So this is easy. It is patent protection has been applied for, and is now available for commercialization. People interested can definitely come forward and acquire the license. This is another product which we've again sourced from US Bangalore, ready to eat honey pan beda. So let me know if I can continue. Ms. Salma. I'll continue. I think it's already 3 now.
So you can continue, sir.
I'll continue, but I will wind up quickly. Okay.
Yes,
this right. This is another technology which has a shelf life of more than 6 months, which is a ready to eat pan, which can be supplied in a pouch form. So this is another technology which we have licensed to 4 companies in the country already. So this is a Nata de Coco from matured coconut water. So this is another product. It's a microbiological product. And this is actually a diet supplement that you could call it. And it has very good nutritional properties. All these years, though the country is well known for its coconut production. And in fact, India has been the highest coconut producer in the world. But we don't have value addition product like this. So these products used to be imported from Indonesia, Malaysia, and other countries. So this now this product technology is available in the country. In fact, DFRL in Mysore and US Bangalore, they have been promoting this product in a big way. And it is a very rich product, very having dietary fibers. And has a lot of other properties like prevention of constipation. Since it is rich in fiber product, so it has all its benefits when it is consumed as a salad along with fruits, or it could be consumed as it is. So this is a technology which we have already licensed to 5 companies in the country. Reputed companies have actually acquired these technologies. Ragi bread or millet bread is another technology which we have sourced from US Bangalore. Snack bar is another technology. Defatting of groundnuts without actually crushing the nuts, you extract the oil. Almost 75% of the oil is extracted without damaging the seed, and subsequently once the seed is once the oil is extracted, the seed contains very less oil, which could be promoted as a low fat defatted nut. This is the, it has both the products, the product of the nut as well as the product of oil. So the oil is having no other constituent except that it is extracted just in a physical form. So it is solvent free and it is a nutritionally rich oil. Oil could be used as a byproduct, and the nut also could be used as a product. And evaluated products from jackfruit. Again, this is from US Bangalore. We've already licensed to one firm in Kerala, and we have several others in pipeline. Potassium humate from lignite. This we have sourced from Neyveli Lignite Corporation. It is basically a soil conditioner. We have licensed to 9 companies. 4 companies have already started production and selling in the market. It has been a huge success. This product has been a very huge success, very popular among the farmers. It can be applied on any crop. This is another technology which we have. This is a series of technologies which we have sourced from various institutions. Crop specific micronutrient formulations for mulberry, cardamom, black pepper, then ginger, turmeric. Of course, we had others also. We have been acquiring and selling these technologies. And there is an average minimum increase in yield of 20% recorded. Because as you are aware, the Indian soils are degraded of the micronutrients. So there was no focus on micronutrients all these years, so the past so many years of cultivation. Since the early 50s to late 1990s, there was no focus on the use of micronutrients in soil. So the deficiencies happened, and so the yield also started degrading, reducing, and even the quality of the crop also started deteriorating. So based on the requirement of these concerned soils, respective soils where these crops are grown, so there is a detailed study which is done, and the physiological requirement of the crop is also measured. And based on both these factors, the crop specific micronutrient formulations are prepared and they are sprayed on the crop. So you get better response in addition to the requirement of NPK. This is another technology, seed coating composition. So there are several such technologies, seaweed extract from Annamalai University. And this is a technology which we have sourced from CCRI Nalipi on coir products. This is another Cocolon, instant Cocolon, which we have licensed to companies in the country, as well as we have exported this technology also. There are a huge list of technologies in the food processing sector. You can see the list here. So we have various R&D institutions, CFTRI, DFRL, many of the agriculture universities across the country. All these technologies have been sourced from all these R&D institutions, and they are ready for commercialization. As I was telling you, Silk Board, we have dedicated silk board where we have technologies on the sericulture sector. So you can see the list of technologies, disinfectants, and a lot of machines on post cocoon and on mulberry. There is a input for mulberries. There are various technologies which are used in the inputs that are required in the rearing of the silkworms. All these products have been very successfully launched and released into the market. So we have a series of disinfectants which have been developed: Resham Jyoti, Vijeta, Resham Kit, Aushad, Lebex, Ankush. So many different disinfectants have been developed for preventing silkworm diseases. This is my last slide here. This is a technology which has been developed by a person who doesn't know how to read and write. So, and he has got a patent in his name, and he has won this WIPO gold medal, which is weighing more than 200 or 250 grams. So it is not the educational background that is required for developing a patent or getting a patent. So it depends on what is your innovation ability, the way you have been working with a particular, working in a particular sector and developing solutions. And probably these particular solutions could be something novel. We don't know. So there is a requirement of identifying such people and documenting their innovations and filing patents, getting protection for them. This is a person, of course, he has passed away as of now, but he was a very brilliant man in the area of developing agricultural equipment. So with his experience over years of more than 50 years of working on agricultural equipment, he developed this multi-purpose deep trencher, and he won a WIPO gold medal for his innovation. Thank you very much for this is in conclusion about my talk. Information on technologies available from NRDC and NRDC assesses commercial potential of innovations. We commercialize novel technologies. We provide value additions to technologies. We organize IPR awareness programs. We facilitate in filing IPRs in the country. We also export technologies in technical services. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to interact with you. I wish you all the best. You can note down my email ID and mobile, just in case if you would like to correspond with me or ask me any questions. Thank you very much. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for that informative talk. Sir, on behalf of management, principal, HOD, staff and students of the Oxford College of Engineering and Department of Biotechnology, we extend our heartfelt appreciation to you, sir, for being part of this STTP program and also enriching our participants with the knowledge that you have given. Hope it is very informative and the participants have some take-home message from this. Thank you, definitely, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Anytime. Yeah, welcome.
Dear participants, this session will continue as our yesterday's session was cancelled due to unavailability of our speaker. We have Colonel Venkat, the director of AICT. He will be joining us for this session, and his session will be continued now, post which the feedback link will be shared with you. Please be on the, please stay back with us.